little goodness. That is the characteristic of the Aquarian age. Greatness is considered to be a mental disease, a delirium, a hysteria, drama. And goodness is the thing that is to replace greatness. Something valuable
is considered to be meaningless in the Aquarian. Something useful is invited. The basic change is taking place without understanding which we will fall back and will be of no use to humanity at all. So, however valuable a thing may be, we cannot present it to the world nowadays without being called a fool after 3 or 4 days. It should be something useful. Something valuable has no place. Something useful has a place. So this is the kind of change that is taking place in the modern age. And we cannot claim authority or personal element. I may have great achievements, but they do not go in my name. Any achievement goes in the name of humanity, not individuals. That's the peculiarity of the Aquarian age. No one need feel any shame of it or disappointed of it. So, the spiritual healing is something which is taking place automatically, making its manifestation at a tremendous speed through individuals. And it is to systematize the approach of these individuals that Master Jyalkul has given the book, The Esoteric Healing. Because the masters know the need of the day. And they are always timely to provide things. Not that they don't have this knowledge before, but they don't impose knowledge unless it is needed. That's the approach of the masters. Just like a good host, they serve only according to the taste and need.
Yeah.
They don't impose upon others. And now it is the need to have the book. According to that book and according to our understanding, let us try to understand the fundamental postulates that are impersonal and that are to be applied to each and every one to heal, to make healing a success. The first postulate is, let the healer be healthy. If a lung specialist suffers from asthma or TB, we lose our confidence. So, we find many healers too nervous, too hysterical, too psychic, and having depressions. They suffer from anxiety, anxiousness in life. They say, I heal. How can you heal? Be healed first. First postulate, first problem. Be ready to use the required branch of healing, that it be allopathy or homeopathy or dietetics or spiritual healing or magnetic. Find out what is required by you. Apply it to yourself. And the second postulate is, it is only a healthy mind that can understand a disease. Because if a patient is irritable, if the doctor is unhealthy, he is also irritable. So, we think that it is a doctor and a patient, but the truth is they are two patients. So here, homeopathy comes to our age and whispers in our ear, my dear doctor, you are having a disease which is called susceptibility to moods. Heal yourself. Select a medicine that is most similar in the mental symptoms to your constitution. Take a dose or two, minimum dosage. Get yourself healed. Get transformed. And test yourself if you can stand calm when your patient is irritated. Then you are ready to heal. So, this is the most important aspect which we have to consider. The second aspect is to heal yourself. Unless you know how to heal yourself, you cannot be a good healer of others. And to heal yourself successfully, what is required? There are two things. One is wrong and the other is right. One. To be conscious of one's own disease. This increases your sickness at a tremendous speed. What is required is, this is negative aspect, you want a positive aspect. Take timely steps, that is what is required. You are not expected to be conscious of your own disease continuously. Taking required steps has nothing to do with being conscious of your disease. They are two different things. The first trait is the most undesirable trait that leads the patient straight to the grave in spite of the best doctor. Because it eats the person. Here, the healer has to switch off the mind of the patient from his disease. He should be able to do it. Otherwise, he cannot be a doctor, he cannot be a healer. I warned you, every medical practitioner cannot be a doctor. Practitioner is different from doctor. A doctor should be able to divert the mind of the patient from negativism to positivism. In order to do this, it's not enough if you suggest to the patient, don't think of the disease, don't think of the disease. That means suggesting him once again about his own disease. Suppose, if I meditate to remove anger from my mind, what happens? I am meditating upon anger. And within a short time, I grow impatient about myself. I am angry upon anger. So there is a trickish way of wrongly tackling us. So, you should create a nucleus of some new activity which is of a positive nature in the mind of the patient. You should engage him off the disease in something which is positive. You should suggest the mind to do something. You can never suggest the mind not to do anything. It is wrong, you will fail. This is the reason why many yogic students fail in their practice of yoga. Because they close their eyes, they suggest to their mind not to think of anything, not to think of anything. After about 5 or 6 or 10 years of yoga practice, you ask him, how do you feel? Do you succeed? Is your mind free from thinking? He says,
just trying. I may succeed in the next few years. You can assure the fellow that he goes to grave without a success, because he is on the wrong line. Not to think of anything, if you suggest to the mind begins to think of it. So, a negative approach is never needed, is never required. A positive approach, ask the mind to do something which eliminates the mind from existence. That is the process of yoga. Ask the mind to observe the movements of the respiration. Like that, suggest something for the fellow. Otherwise, he is too mischievous. There was a little story, allegory about the mind in the Indian tradition. See? A fellow went to a Swamiji and asked him, "You give me a mantra to do with which I can conquer all the world." And the Swamiji said, "Dangerous. Don't have such thoughts," he said. But the fellow insisted, "Give me the mantra if you know." The Swamiji said, "I know it, but it is dangerous." He said, "If you know, give it to me. Then I'll give it to you. Do this mantra for 21 days. A great giant will stand before you. He can do anything in this world. But it is up to you to suggest something every moment to him. The moment you fail to suggest anything, he will eat you." This is what is called mind. The giant is mind. This is a story, a parable about the mind. And the fellow, he meditated upon the mantra for 20 days. And on 21st day, there was the giant standing before him, said, "What do you want?" And he said, "Oh, meals." And the giant, "Here is meals, eat." And he is eating. "Next, tell me something. Water." He said, "Here is water." Then he was agitated. He said, "Take this table and put it there." And the giant said, "It is there." And when he saw the table was not here, it was there. "And put this table there," then said. Then he said, "Take this house there." And the giant said, "It is there." "Take this mountain there." Then the fellow lost his head and he did not know what to do. And the giant opened his mouth, "I will eat you." And then he ran and ran to the Swamiji, in the meanwhile speaking, "Bring water, bring tumbler, bring watch, bring paper." He was bawling out and running, and he ran to the Swamiji and fell upon his feet, said, "Save me." Then Swamiji said, "What is it? This fellow is eating me. You take him away. I don't want this mantra. You cancel it." And the Swamiji said, "I know only the mantra. I don't know the process of cancelling it. It is my guru." "That's the reason why I didn't meditate upon this mantra. It was there with me for a long time, but I don't know how to cancel it. Go to my guru." "Where is he?" "He is in the Alps." So, from Scandinavia to Alps, this fellow ran. And then there was his guru. Why are you so much frightened?" He said, "The giant is chasing me. He will eat me." "Don't worry. He will not approach. There, my presence is there. Sit down for some time. Eat and drink the water. Take coffee and take bread. Now that. And then tell me." "The giant is there," he said. "I will tell you a solution which is very easy. You would have yourself discovered it, poor fellow. I will tell you." And in his ear, he whispered something. "Oh, it is so easy," he said, "the solution. Now I will tackle the giant." And he went there. The giant said, "Something to do." Then he said, "Bring a big pillar here." The giant said, "Here is the pillar. Establish it here. Then the pillar is fixed.
Then he said, go up the pillar. The giants went up and cried from there. He said, come down. He came down. Go up, come down, go up, come down. Be doing this until I call you.
So, until October 14th, 1983, the giant is going up and coming down, going up and coming down. This is the little story about mind, narrated in the legendary fables of India. So, how to control the mind? Not by thinking about the mind or asking the mind to control, but by suggesting something which is significant, which can control the mind. So, create a new center of activity to the mind. Let it be a fine art, a science, a pursuit, a study, where the fellow is kept active. I know my experience with this. We have as many as 83 big clinics in India conducted by my students in the what I call the new era healing, which includes allopathy, homeopathy, naturopathy and spiritual healing, supplementation healing. And there people come forward to help the patients and to work in the clinic daily. They come with some diseases with which they are suffering for a long time, and when they begin to work, within 6 months or 1 year or 2 years, they find wonderful development and they are healthy. For the first time, they feel the real meaning of health, because they stopped thinking of their own health and they began to think of the health of others. This is my experience, and in 80% of the cases, it is a success. The fellows needed no much medicine at all. They needed only a diversion of the mind from their own disease. So, one of the wonderful principles of healing is, see that the patient is not continuously conscious of his own sufferings. You find some people always talking of their own disease and complaining about how they suffer again and again. If you want to talk something, once again they will draw you into their own subject. Within 2 minutes they speak of their own disease and suffering. You will find that they are not cured. They go to hundreds of doctors. They change doctors, change remedies and medicines. They change various systems of medicine, but they are worse day after day, because they dwell upon their own disease and they meditate upon disease and they are disease conscious. Unless the healer is able to divert the mind of the fellows upon something, a real healing is not possible. So, without making these corrections, you cannot be a spiritual healer. This is the second aspect of it. The third aspect of healing, the healers heal through the tips of the fingers, they heal through sight, they heal through voice. There are many methods of healing. The secret is magnetism. When once you develop healing magnetism, it can be operated either through your sight or through your voice and conversation or through your fingers or through your touch. If at all you develop healing magnetism, it can be utilized in any way. You can use your leg or hand or head, anything. You can sometimes kick the fellow and heal sometimes. So, don't specify exclusively a method to heal. Have all the methods. One method is useful in one case, another method is useful in another case. and your common sense should be your constant teacher. The way of applying is with you, the keys are with you. Many times we don't use common sense. It is there with us, safe, protected by us, not utilized. That's why Blavatsky says in his Secret Doctrine, it is wrongly called common sense because it is rarely used. So, you cannot apply the same rule as to a second patient which you applied to the first patient. For example, the naturopath suggests fasting. It works with certain people. It works havoc with certain people. So, you should be careful to suggest fasting to Mr. X and to suggest Mr. Y not to fast. You should understand it. If a cardiac patient of an advanced stage were asked to fast, he will die. Should be careful. There are certain patients who are better by fasting, but there are certain patients who may die by fasting. And suppose the Hatha Yoga teacher suggests the same asana to every patient to cure himself. In some patients, it is wonderful. The cure is wonderful. In some patients, it works dangerously and there are casualties. For example, Sirsasana, head down posture. You suggest Sirsasana to a fellow having some bodily pains and some debility, etc. It is wonderful. But you suggest it to a fellow having a history of epileptic sickness, the grand mal. The fellow immediately gets the attack whenever he does Sirsasana, because blood rushes to the head and the fellow has the attack once again, the crisis is there. And from that day onwards, his epilepsy increases until it is too damaging. Sometimes there will be a condition of stasis. So, you should have a selective and judicious way of applying methods. Then only you are called a healer and a doctor. So, you should be able to use your fingers or your sight. Many times you should practice it without professing that you are healing. Then you will be able to heal to a maximum extent, because 50% of the patients, they are doctor conscious, doctor sensitive and healer sensitive. A patient feels sensitive as long as the doctor is there sometimes. Then the doctor cannot have a normal understanding of his pulse and heart and respiration, because he is agitated. When the doctor goes, within 10 minutes, the fellow is having another pulse rate and another heartbeat and another type of respiration. We had a better experience when we were students. I was 16 and we were studying in a college, and there was a medical test for all of us every year. And the doctor has remarked for more than 95% of the patients suffering from heart palpitation. Something wrong. The professors and the principal of our college, they were very much worried, annoyed. Why so many students are having palpitation of heart? What's the hell of it? Something wrong with the medical examination. Once again conducted with another doctor. But quite normal. No fellow was suffering from heart palpitation. In the first case, you know what happened? The doctor arranged his examination in the third floor. And the students are required to walk up the three floors. And when they're gasping and when they see the doctor, they have the nervous palpitation and then immediately they are tested. Except a few fellows who have no sensitivity of the doctor, all the others are reported as having heart palpitation, heart palpitation, heart palpitation. I too was classed among them. And again, this is what happens with the doctor. So, if the healer professes that he is a healer, there are many patients who are sensitive. And the moment a patient feels sensitive of the doctor or a healer, the centers that have to be opened up to the energies of healing, they close, they get blocked. There will be a blockage of energy centers. And it is very, very difficult for the healer to tackle the cases. So, the best way of, the most effective way of healing is not to profess yourself as a healer. Of course, it is in a way sickening and discouraging because the healer is not recognized. That's the great trouble. If the healer is having a hysteria called fame consciousness, then he cannot have this method. But while traveling in a train, you can heal wonderfully. In an aeroplane, in a bus, or you are sitting among 10 people talking, you can engage them in a sprightly conversation, a humorous discussion, when it is the best time for you to supplement healing magnetism because all their energy centers are opened. This is how you have to do. Even the doctor who uses medicine, it is for him to have a friendly contact with the patient because his magnetism heals while his medicine cures. Then you find the best results. And a healer who denies the use of the medicine is a fool. I talked of supplementation. One should have supplementation. And then the next caution is let the healer and the patient not sit on the same level or stand. No healing takes place. If you stand on the floor and ask the patient to stand on the floor, begin to heal, no healing takes place. Or if you sit in a chair and if ask the patient to sit in another chair of the same level, no healing takes place. The patient should be in a lower level than the healer. Then automatically healing takes place because healing magnetism flows in a geotropical manner from above downwards. And just as a magnetism cannot be seen, carries its own lines of force which can be proved only with the help of iron filings. Another magnet, when it is brought to the South Pole, there will be a big fight between the invisible currents of magnetism, which is not seen by us. But the two magnets are repelled. We say that they are repelled, but there is a tremendous activity, undesirable and negative activity going on between the two poles, which is not visible. Same thing happens if the patient is asked to sit on a higher pedestal than the healer, and the healer begins to heal. He has to heal on the wall, only the wall and the chair, and not the patient. Even in experiments of hypnotism, let it be the best hypnotist. Let the patient sit on the table, and they let the hypnotist sit on the floor. Let him hypnotize anyone. See, it is always a failure. It cannot be a success. Because vital magnetism, that is human magnetism, flows from one person to another from about the onwards.
Why, you can ask? It is arranged that the earth receives
this magnetism through the rays of the sun. The rays of the sun travel from above the universe. That's the reason why the human magnetism also flows from above the universe. So, you cannot ignore natural law and the process of the natural phenomena. So, this is another principle. Ask the patient to sit a little bit lower than you, not too low. If you sit here and make the patient sit somewhere here, there is no contact. If you ask the patient to stand on the street and you stand here, through the window you can't see. You should understand how a contact is established and how a circuit is completed. Understand the phenomenon of magnetism and electricity and the working of the electromagnet and the law of alternation of currents. Then you will be able to understand how healing takes place. So, let there be a difference of 4 feet to 6 feet, not less than that, not more than that. If it is more than 6 feet, the patient is out of reach to your magnetism. If it is less than 4 feet, it is inconvenient. Magnetism never flows from you into the patient. Another aspect is the distance factor. If you sit here, ask the patient to sit here, you can never heal. There should be the minimum distance, just like in photography. You cannot use a camera, however superior it may be, or a lens, unless you have the minimum required distance. If you put the cactus here, you cannot see. Should have some distance, convenient distance, and not too much distance. You can heal a person who is sitting at a distance of a minimum 6 feet. That is a human height distance. The distance of an average human being's height, the height of human being. 6 to 20 feet. Maximum you can conduct healing to a person who is sitting at the end of this room. Beyond this, you can't do. If you have a big hall and have a patient on the other side of the hall, if you stand here, you have to heal yourself. You can't heal the patient. No communication is possible. Here the distance factor is to be considered. Another thing is, you should be able to use a vehicle. The best vehicle to heal is sound. That's why the ancients gave us the method of catch words or holy sounds, the name of God or mantra. In the name of God, healing is done. That is the way how they do it through ages. You know how Jesus the Christ was healing, and they asked him how to heal. He said, in the name of God. That is the secret. What is the name of God, by the way? Everyone has his own name of God, unfortunately. But there should be one name of God which heals. Then God said, you utter my name. Then the disciple asked, when I go to Egypt and when they ask me, what is the name of your God? What should I say? What was the answer? What is the name given by God to Moses? Master key. God never said his name was this. If God had said, my name is I am that I am, Moses would have gone to Egypt and said, he is that he is. My God is, he is that he is. God never said, I am that I am, but he said, tell him, I am that I am. That is what he used. That means, the person who goes there should tell him, I am that I am. He should never tell, he is that he is. You should know how mantras are given in the scriptures. But unfortunately, when the Old Testament is translated into English, there is much confusion in many places. The mantra lost its purity and only the meaning is translated in many places. For example, in some other place, it is said, I am unique. That means no plurality is accepted. But unfortunately, it is translated in a nasty way. I, the Lord God, am a jealous God. That is the translation. So, God is made ugly and jealous because of the translator.
Man, what did Jesus say about the name of God? I am the way. I am life. I am resurrection.
But the Sunday teacher teaches us, he is life. He is life. He is the way. He is resurrection. No, it is not he is, but it is I am. God should exist in your heart, not in the picture or in the church or in the tower. So, this is the mantra. In the Bhagavad Gita, he said, I am the one who initiated the sun god into the first existence. That means, when there was no sun to this solar system, there was no solar system existing. In the space, there was an awakening whose meaning is I am. And then there was the existence of the sun. And he shines forth from that time onwards. So, the healer should have this as the name of God. Through the I am of every healer, healing occurs. That is what Jesus said, in the name of God. But we have, unfortunately, two I ams. One is the false I am, Antichrist, and the other is the real I am, the Lord. We should be able to utter the name of the real I am. Just within half a minute, I will speak of it. We have the five senses and the mind working. The one is sense of sight, the second is sense of hearing, the third is sense of smell, sense of taste, sense of touch. These are the five senses we are having, through which the mind is working and through which the environment is forcing itself upon the mind. And the mind is receiving the environment and reacting to the environment. So we live in constant reaction as long as we are existing. The moment we sleep, we do not exist. But as long as we exist, we react and we live in reactions. Therefore, we have no time to know ourselves and have our action which is natural to us.
So, the mind and the five senses put together is called the negative I am.
Who is the false existence of the entity. So we have a false existence of ourselves
and a real existence, the real I am.
Who shines forth as mind and who shines forth as the five senses and the faculties, and he has no sleep. This fellow sleeps, that is the mind and the senses. And we say we sleep. In fact, we don't sleep. If we sleep, what happens? The heart sleeps, the lungs sleep, and the body has to be thrown into cemetery. So we are not sleeping. It is only the mind and the senses that are sleeping. Whereas we are there, taking care that the lungs are respiring, and the heart is beating, and the blood is circulating, and the food we have eaten is being digested. We eat sometimes heavy dinner and we sleep. What happens if the stomach also sleeps? What happens when the lungs, if the lungs sleep, if the heart sleeps? For 2 minutes give me rest, if the heart asks. For 2 minutes, within the 2 minutes, the fellow goes away from the body. So the fact is, we are not sleeping. It is only the mind and the senses, the false I am or the negative I am, the fellow who is sleeping. He is called the indweller, who is always conditioned by the environment. And the real dweller is called the Lord. So his name is I am that I am. So this is the import of all the scriptures of all nations of all times. Though each scripture is possessed by a separate religion, the scriptures are above religion and beyond religion, and they give us the same name of God, and the hearer is concerned with this name. He should know how to help a communion with the Lord. This fellow having establishing a communion with this Lord is what is called yoga. The word yoga in Sanskrit means a union in the lower sense, a communion in the higher sense, and living as one with him in the highest sense. That is synthesis. Just as the petals of the flower with the flower live with the flower as one, we should live with the Lord. And you should practice this as a healer. Not that you have to practice all the 8 steps of yoga path, but you should be able to discriminate between the true I am and the false I am in you. The false I am includes the lower principles in you, which we call the physical, the etheric, and the mental. The physical plane is what we call the body. The etheric plane is what we call the vital force in homeopathy. The mental plane is the fellow who is working through the five senses. These three put together form the lower fellow, who is the false I am, who is the false existence. And there is the fourth one. It's called we are Buddhi.
which forms the fulcrum principle between the lower and the higher.
And then there are the three higher principles.